All right, well, we're just going to start. So in today's stream, we're going to do another common game engine component of a drop-down console that you can use to issue developer commands and look at variables and stuff. The history of this sort of goes back to Quake 1. Quake 1 had a cool little console that drops down when you hit backtick and it pops back up. And we had one of those in The Witness, and I didn't have the forethought to run the developer version of The Witness early enough to crunch all the assets so I could show this to you. So if it finishes sometime soon, I can demonstrate to you very quickly how this kind of console works. Absent of that visual demonstration, I'll just talk about what we're going to do. I suppose I could download Quake or something, but we won't. It'll become evident what we're doing as we do it if you don't know what this is. To sort of guide the implementation, I'm going to look at the Witnesses console, which we have already written in C++. And it's not that much code. It's, you know, 1,000 lines in the CPP file and like 100 lines in the H file. And in fact, there is a bunch of stuff that was added to this console that I didn't do. So I wrote the original version and it was pretty simple, but it lacked some features that you would like. Like it didn't have completion, you know, like you could hit tab and complete commands now. And it didn't have a scroll bar and stuff. And so that stuff was added later by other people. And I'm probably gonna skip that stuff in the beginning, like the scroll bar and whatever, and we'll add those after the implementation initially happens. And so part of the exercise here, as always, is I'm not going to auto-convert this source code. I'm just going to sort of look at the C++ version and retype it or paste it and reconfigure it, paste parts of it. But for the most part, I'm trying to do it cleaner, and I'm trying to look for ways in which this language can help the implementation and make it cleaner and simpler and more fun. Now, there's sort of two parts to this, and I think we're going to do them in at least two streams, depending on the progress. So one is just the user interface part of being able to pop down a command console and like type commands into it and get a reply, right? So I'm going to try to do that first. But then there's the other part of what are the commands that you type into the console and how do those work? And that part is a little bit separate, and on that part, I actually want to use metaprogramming to make it easier to deal with, which will be cool. It's now Windows Firewall is blocking the witness, which means maybe it's trying to do something. It drew something on the screen now. Anyway, Emacs is freaking out. Okay, so. But that second thing about the commands, I think the new way that it's going to work is going to be different enough from the old way that we probably won't even look much at the C++ version. And the other cool thing is, so this console system, typically one of the things that we use it for is to inspect the values of those variables that we did on a previous stream. I guess it was yesterday or something, like that tweak file. This one, right, like whatever variables you're going to define in here, you're sort of able to just navigate this hierarchy as if it were a directory hierarchy. Like we have cd and ls commands in the console where you contextually navigate these. Now that's not as good as a GUI for that, and maybe we'll just do a straight up GUI for it as well later on. But it's a good like early test of the console to make sure that you can at least navigate and change these variables. Right? So let's just sort of get started. Let's look at the C++ version. Is there any questions about what even I'm talking about to begin with? This console is so old that I used a linked list to store which. It originally was going to have tabs. Actually, that's probably something we'll add in this implementation. I never got around to adding tabs to the console, which it should have. Pitbot is confused. Does anyone have a specific question? Maybe I'll just start. So the first thing that you want, do I not like linked lists? What would you use instead of them if you did it today? I would use an array, because linked lists, unless the one activity that you need to be fast is, well, singly linked lists are almost not good for anything now. And the problem is that your nodes of the list tend to be in random places in memory. So it's very slow because you have to pull that memory into cache as you navigate the list. Now, if the one thing that you need to do is make removing an element from a linked list very fast, then you could use a doubly linked list, and that makes removal quick if the list is very long. But other than that, you pretty much, in a modern system, you want to use arrays for everything, which is why, for example, in the language, we use arrays as one of our fundamental types. We don't have a fundamental type for list, because there's not much of a point, honestly. So someone's asking, you're going to use metaprogramming to ease up things. Can you tell some examples? I don't want to get too off track from the high-level mission statement, so I think we'll save that for the next stream when I'm actually going to implement that, because it'll make more sense. Once we get the graphical part of this down and it's obvious what we're doing, then the rest of it will have more context and it'll make more sense. Oh, God. People always ask, why are you creating your own programming language? And it's like, look, just take that as a given that there is a programming language, and we're going on from there. Oh, you actually mean for the variables file, not for the rest of this code. I think he means this. And the reason is because you want this kind of file to be very simple and very fast to load, and you actually don't really want a Turing-complete programming language for a simple file like this. Like, I don't want to have to deal with the question of, I'm just trying to load a variable, but there's a complex expression to evaluate on the right-hand side, and what complex does that run in? And what happens at runtime if I'm on a PlayStation 4 console and I don't want to, like, instantiate an entire interpreter engine just to run this thing? And if I did, I don't know what that engine is doing to the heap and how much it's fragmenting my memory. You don't want any of that garbage, right? You just want name value, name value. At least that's what I want, right? So for something like this, I don't want a language like Lua here or any, programming language. I just want a mapping from names to values. So if that's what the question was, then that's the answer. Okay, this is too many off-topic questions. We're going to stick to the topic right now, which is implementing this console. So the first thing we're going to do is just make a window that pops open and closed, and that one thing that I like about the console in the witness is that we actually have two versions of it being open. You can pop it open a little bit so that it just kind of takes up the top of the screen and then you mostly see the game under it, or you can hit shift and the tick mark, and it comes way open and covers most of the screen for when you're doing serious stuff in the console, right? So I'm going to copy that part of it. So, I think there's really not going to be much copying. It's going to be just like looking at the C++ version for reference. So let's make file for it. We're going to go into the main, and we're going to say load console. We're going to go to console, and I'm going to, You know, there's only one of these. So in C++, you know, I did this thing where console is in a class. Whoops, I went to the wrong file. You know, I did this thing, the C++ thing where I put console in a class and it's got all these variables, and like, I don't think we're gonna do that. I think we're gonna make all these variables local to the file, and if you ever wanted to instantiate multiple of these, you would use the trick that I showed last time of just loading the module multiple times or something. But let's copy some of these things. So we've got a font that we use for input. I forget what my fonts are called. Yeah, it's still called dynamic font. And we've got a report font that the text of the console is drawn in. And I'm gonna ignore a lot of these variables till I need them. We're gonna want this one. Command shell is something for later. That's when we start dealing with variables and stuff. And oh wait, openness max. I did the wrong thing there. So these are like, how open is the console right now? How open does it want to be? Because it's updating slowly frame by frame. And what's the rate at which it's opening? So we're going to copy all those. So it's going to start closed. It's going to start wanting to be closed. These are floats, so let's just do that. And it's not trying to open or close. And openness max, I guess, is the most that it'll ever come open. And I guess that's probably a fraction. We'll check this, but I guess it's a fraction of screen space, so let's do that. Oh, and I guess when we started up, we set this. So all of these variables, anything like how fast does it open and what's the maximum that it can open, we'll put later on in a tweak struct that we can tweak from that file. But for now, we'll just even just make them globals. We'll factor them later. What's the point of sliding the console down, someone is asking, as opposed to opening it immediately? It's nicer to slide it down. If you want it to open immediately for your own personal edification, you could just set dopendt to a very high number in your local.variables, and then you would have a snappy console. And we'll probably do that. It's just nice to have it slide open. Like, there's a thing about computers. Things that are instantaneous are a little bit frightening for the nervous system, right? I mean, it's hard to explain, but computers make people anxious a lot of the time, and I think it's because of that. Because in nature, if anything ever happens that fast, it's probably potentially dangerous, right? And you want people to feel good using your stuff. People are asking off-topic questions. Please stay on topic for a while, because it takes time on the stream for me to look over and see that all your questions are off-topic, and then people watching on YouTube later are just going to see me staring at the screen for a while with nothing happening. So I need to get someone to edit these after they happen, maybe. Okay. So we've got this stuff, and let's just go look at the code that does this stuff. Let's just say there's a draw procedure using, oh, you know what, we're not going to make a struct, right? So we're just going to be straight up this way. Let's say that this stuff is in file scope and this stuff is in export scope, and We're going to update openness because that's a useful thing to have abstracted into its own thing. We'll assert that input font and report font exist. Whoops. And then let me just some of these things are different in the new system. So, but I'm just going to copy the lines. We need to set up our transform. We need to apply our shader. Actually, in GL, we might have to do the transform after the shader. I don't know, but that's usually how I think it, this order doesn't matter, but we'll see. And then we figure out the dimensions of our console. We declare occlusion, which this is a thing for managing where button presses go. Like if you're running the editor, you want to know that the console is covering the editor. I'm not going to worry about, so this stuff down here is mouse pointer stuff, which I'm not going to worry about because that's probably for clicking on the text to edit in the middle of the text, which is a feature that we'll add later. For now, I just want the basic console. And then we draw a couple of rectangles. And then we draw a text input, which I don't know if text inputs work. I sort of ported them a long time ago, but we'll see. And then this is for like all the previous text in the console, which we're not going to have yet. We're just going to draw the rectangle for now and the scroll bar. And here's update openness. Let's copy all this stuff. Well, this, okay. This is going to be back in file scope. And there's obviously some things. We've got some states, console closed, console open. So we need those. And I'm not going to worry it. Well, yeah, let's do it. Enum console state. Whoops. We don't need that. We'll just say console closed. Oh, small, open, big. Right? So if your state is open, big, or open, small, and you toggle, we'll go to closed. Otherwise, we go to the other one. Yeah, we only update openness when we draw because we're assuming you're going to draw the console every frame. So let's go to that. Let's go to update openness. Right, so what is my DT in this system? It's this. We want the real world clock and not the game clock because we want it to feel smooth regardless of your frame rate or whatever. We want it to open at a constant rate regardless of your frame rate and whatever's happening. Right, so, and then dopen is DT times dopen DT. And this is all comes straight over from C++. So if we're less than we want to be, then we open more and don't let us go past the max, stop at the max. And if we're higher than we want to be, then we go less. So all this stuff that I'm implementing right now, it might be a fun third stream after the console is done to go back in and do like extra snazzy look and feel on the console, because this is a relatively robotic opening, right? It's like, let's open at a constant rate, and when we get exactly to where we're going, stop, right? And then close at a constant rate, and when we're done, stop. And it might be fun, even though console is kind of a programmer thing, it might be fun to put a little extra flair into it. But we'll think about that later on. So that's update openness. This we're probably not calling yet, but open or close me, this is what we're gonna call from the UI. Open, we'll call it open or close console, because again, there's only one console. Huh, interesting though. You know what, I feel like, these are actually gonna wanna be public, because I think whoever calls us is gonna say open us big or open us small or whatever. So this is gonna be console state.strict using console state.members. No, we just do this. Closed, open small, open big. And then we update openness. We call this actually, because on the same frame, it feels snappier if on the same frame where you tell the console to do something new, it starts responding, right? If you wait until the next frame, that's not necessarily good. And depending on when this happens relative to when the console draws, you know, it might happen differently. Someone is saying, I worked on a console for a game once in Lua, and I found commands to potentially be an issue as they were running on the main thread. We actually, so this is a little bit of a sidetrack. This is more for the second stream of this probably, but I will say in the witness, you know, we programmed a lot of commands, and a lot of them were very computationally intensive because they would do stuff like validate something about the game state or search the game world for certain kinds of objects. And the problem is you want that to be in the main thread because otherwise you have to deal with data synchronization of your world state when you're writing those commands, and it makes those commands much harder to write. So I think you just want to suffer the fact that your frame rate is going to kind of die when you run those commands, because otherwise you're making your job a lot harder. Someone is asking, how relevant is MVC to how I work? What is MVC? Is that model view controller or something? What, like, oh, you people. I don't know what people are learning about how to program. The model view controller, isn't that some weird Microsoft idea? Okay, so anyway, so in this system we say set shader. We do have a shader, ARGB, no texture, I think. We do have a rendering 2D right-handed. These are called back buffer whatever. Take off the F. Yeah, we don't do object-oriented programming here, really. I mean, we do a small amount of things that look a little bit like what you do when you're object-oriented programming. But no, I mean, any concept from OOP, probably I don't take it very seriously. And I realize that that's very different from what a lot of people do and what you'll learn in school and in a lot of places on the internet. But that's just how it is on this stream. I don't remember what color switches these are. Everyone wants to know what color switches are on my keyboard. I just bought a keyboard that sounded good. This is the Razer Chroma whatever tournament edition. Because Casey liked it, and it's fine, except it has this stupid annoying thing that Razer's doing lately about flipping the symbols on the keys, which I really don't like. And I might throw this keyboard out, not throw it out, but stop using it and make it be the spare keyboard just because of that, because it's so annoying. It's like the most like hipster dumb thing, and it actually wrecks my concentration because I have to think about the keys when I look at them. So I'm not totally endorsing this keyboard. It's fine to type on, but I'm not recommending getting it. Would there be any disadvantage to doing a clamp at the end of the function instead of using if blah, blah, blah and separate if else branches? No, there wouldn't really be. And in fact, I thought about doing it that way. He's talking about this. Down here. So instead of testing this and testing that, I could just say plus equals or minus equals D open, and then down here I could say like clamp open T from 0 to open T target. And you know, and so we would be getting rid of these. And that does look cleaner, and that's fine. The only reason I'm not doing it is because I think for future purposes, this is actually better. Like, if I want to play a little subtle sound effect when we finish opening or when we finish closing, this and this is when we know when that happened, right? So, you actually want those cases explicitly in your code. And after you do game programming enough, you start to notice those times. It's like, yeah, this isn't the simplest thing, but I'm going to need this. I'm going to need to understand that this is a state transition later on, so let's keep it. So that's kind of why I make those. I just spilled my tea all over the place. We're going to have a 2-minute break while I mop up my tea. We'll be right back. This might be some serious tea. Well, I've mopped up the tea mess, got a replacement tea. My to-do list got spilled all over, so that's down for the count. Okay, 3-minute break is over. So, we've got update openness, we've got open or close console, we've got console is open. And So now, oh, we were in the middle of adapting draw here. Let's not worry about declare occlusion yet, because that only matters when we're interacting with the editor. I'm just going to simplify some of this stuff. So we don't need that, we don't need that. Don't need that. So we're going into immediate mode rendering again. And console rectangle is just a helper that draws a rectangle, but I think we already have something that'll do this. So draw quad. Yeah, we have this immediate draw quad, which is fine. So we'll do that, and we'll do that, and then let's go back to the C++ version for a second, because I don't think I... Yeah, so I'm just going to put these as globals for a bit, and then again, we'll make them tweakable later. Input background color. So we're going to have background and text colors for the input region, which is just where you type, and then for the report region, which is the rest of the console. So this is a vector for input text color. Is a vector for. You know, I almost kind of want like a non... Like, you want to be able to line up identifiers like this with some kind of character that doesn't count in the identifier. Like, that would be kind of interesting. Anyway, so we have those for the input region, and then we have those for the report region. And I'm just going to set these every frame here for now, because, you know, later they're going to be tweak variables. Well, let's put it in an init procedure. So init console. Oh, and this should be draw console. And then what were my report back in the C++ version? What were my reports? Text color. What do you mean? I don't have a report text color. Well, that's an oversight. I must have hard coded it. So let's just add those things and we'll make it a different color. What did I make? I must have a report background. Oh, okay. What it was each tab has a separate background color. We won't do that yet, but we'll do that eventually. Let's just swap our R and G here for now. These are going to be probably some very ugly... I don't know. These are going to be some ugly colors. Actually, this text is going to be unreadable on this background. Whatever. Yeah, backslash might connect identifiers. It's just that seems kind of ugly. But then maybe if your editor de-emphasized this, it might be fine. Like if it just drew that really dim. I don't know. It's an interesting thought. Because I do this all the time. Like I have variables that are supposed to be associated with each other, but like words are different lengths in the middle of the variable, right? Okay. Can you enforce people not to run anything compile time? Yes, you can have a compile time metaprogram that rejects any programs that contain any other directives apart from the one that launched that compile time metaprogram. Okay. Let's do this. So we're sort of almost to the point, we can't use this console yet because we have not hooked it up to anything, but it feels like we're getting toward the point. I kind of feel like this baseline height, we'll make that zero for now. I feel like that's a concept that is not relevant. Now we're not going to try to input text yet. So, you know, maybe this will compile now. I mean, I've probably made a mistake somewhere, but maybe it'll compile. Let's find out. Oh, look, the witness is running. So this is the witness. This is a game that I worked on previously. And, you know, whenever I play this now, I feel like the field of view is, why is my field of view cranked? I don't know. Anyway, so this is the witness. This is a game. This is the developer version, so we're drawing the frame rate in the upper right corner and stuff. It's probably too small for you to really see on the stream. Oh, I don't have the console enabled. What? Why? The whole reason I ran this was to show the console. Oh, we have it bound to F1. Duh. I was hitting the Quake. It's been so long since I did witness stuff. So I hit F1 here. And I can toggle this. You can see we never really made an effort to make this console look good. But so I hit F1 and to pop it open and close. If I hit Shift F1, it'll come way open, right? So this is the main thing that I want to do is the console. And this is like, well, I still want to play the game or see the game, but I want to type into the console, right? So I can do stuff like, I can do ls and I see all my subfolders and those are all variables. So I can do something like, you know, cd physics, and let's look in there and print gravity. So, you know, there's these basic console commands, and actually there's a ton of console commands. Oh, these are the built-in ones, and there's probably like 100 console commands that we added. I actually don't know if there's a way to get a list of those. Anyway, the rest of this, you know, the cd and ls is kind of like a simple shell. I can quit the game from the console. So that's kind of what we're doing right now. If that helps make things any clearer. Okay. I gotta close some windows here. I got too many windows open. All right. Oh yeah, assert here doesn't like things that are not. I need to fix that because I like saying assert with a non-Boolean. Okay, window x0. So I didn't copy that from the window x0. So these units. Okay. Yeah, so this is a little bit of too redundant setting of variables, really, but like this YA and YB are not even used anymore. And this is just saying I want it to go from all the way on the left to all the way on the right, but this is tweakable. Let's actually make those more global. Because why not? That'll actually remind us that they exist. Get console bottom. Turn lerp between one. Oh no, YB is used. Ah. So, that's a little bit weird, but, you know. Who's calling that? Get console bottom, it's line 51. I don't understand why this is as convoluted as it is. Yeah, so YA is not used. So YB is like, how far down the screen do we allow ourselves to come, I guess. Which seems redundant with openness max. You know, anytime you go to old code like this, you're gonna see some things. Right. Oh, and there's no this because this is not an object. Float versus integer, right? So we don't do automatic float to integer conversion in all cases. Okay, so now these, so we have these background colors we did before, and this version of DrawQuad wants an integer color, so we say input bg color is ARGB color, which converts this into a packed 32-bit int of input background color, right? And then report. Okay, so we have a bunch of potential overloads and we didn't match any of them. Oh, because you know what? I was being goofy. Yeah, let's go back to having a console quad because we're passing floats. These are just like, because we know that this console is axis aligned. And in fact, you know what? We'll have console quad take the float color so we don't have to do this. Right? And then, yeah, so we're just going to do our own thing. X0 float, Y0 float, X1 float, Y1 float, color vector 4. And we're going to say, we're just going to make points. We're going to make 4 points for a quad. X0, Y0, X1, Y0, X1, Y1, X0, Y1. And let's make Z here just in case we want to change that for some reason. And we'll say immediate quad P0, P1, P2, P3, Z. Okay, because, right. So we're passing integer screen coordinates and there's always a question about whether I want to be pedantic about the fact that screen coordinates are integer, which you often want them to be because if you're trying to be meticulous about anti-aliasing and stuff, then you care. Okay, I still haven't. Now, uh, Well, let's look at the overloads of immediate quad. So we've got four vector twos and a U32 color. We've got four vector threes and a normal and a U32 color. Okay, that's the problem. So let's make these vector twos, whatever. Let's cut out the Z. Because we're doing 2D drawing and whatever. Oh, and this should be color, ARGB color, color. I don't know what I was smoking when I typed that. Okay, and then these are vector twos. Okay, so now, wait, these are actually floats? Okay, never mind. All this stuff I said about being pedantic. I don't know what I was. One of them is probably an int, yeah. Like Y1 is an int for some reason, so that's the only problem. Yeah. So we're actually dealing in floats here. Like I said, I'm a little bit inconsistent about that, and I shouldn't be. Okay, well, we compiled, and we still run. We don't have a console because, we haven't hooked it up. It compiles. Okay, so. We have this init console, which we're not calling yet, so let's not forget to call that. So let's init console. I don't particularly know when we should. Let's actually init console after we init the text, the localization and stuff, because we might want to set labels or whatever. And right, let's actually do it down here. And these fonts we need to set. Input font, get font at size, font folder. I don't know. Let's just make both of these the same size to start. And we want probably a fixed width font maybe for this console. And we have one in the folder here, run tree data fonts. In Consolata is pretty good, so let's use that. But you know what? Let's put that in it, console. Okay, that compiles. Let's make sure that runs. Okay, that's good. So now, we got to draw the console. Let's not forget that. We got to draw the console. Draw game view. Okay, regardless of whether we're in the game or the editor or whatever, we're going to draw that. And then we're going to draw the console as the last thing before we swap buffers. Now this still, I mean, it may crash for all I know if I did something really stupid, but we still won't see anything. But now, here's what I could do is I could just say, you know what? We're just going to hard code this to open before we hook it up to input. Let's just open it big, right? And we're just going to do it every frame after we draw for the first time. Whatever. We don't care. And we don't see anything. So we get to debug that. So update openness. open T is this, target is this. I should get back into the habit of using a debugger on this kind of stuff, but uh, 3.0, all right, that's fine. This could be not appearing for many reasons. Like, we could be drawing the geometry in the right place, but with the wrong shader set, or like, we could be scissored, or God only knows. Those look like valid screen coordinates to me. So at this point, let's bust out RenderDoc again and just see what it says about what we're doing. Capture executable, C, Sophron, tree, Sopho, debug.exe, capture. And it doesn't always work for some reason. All right. So by now the console should be open. I'm hitting print screen, exiting. All right. So it should be like the last thing that we draw, approximately. Not that, well, maybe, but I feel like my transform is not set correctly. So well, no. Here, I wonder if there's a way to mark these calls. Anyway, this is sort of the, oh no, 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 this is probably the, this is the HDR to LDR pass, right? If I go to, can I see what the shader is? I don't know how to use this very well. This last quad is, this is a full screen quad that is, you know, 0, 0 to 1, 1, and it's just blitting us to the HDR buffer, probably. So the console is gonna be one of these. Now, these do not look like very good numbers to us, which would imply that the transform yeah, okay, so our alpha here, for example, is 0.7. I don't know where these UVs are coming from, but our alpha is 0.7, which if we look, well, maybe that's what 230 over 255 is. No, it's 0.9. But maybe that gets, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what this is. Oh, that's probably the ocean. No. Oh, ocean, top alpha. Right, we changed the ocean yesterday. So that's an ocean quad. So this is weirding me out because we should be drawing the console after we draw anything in the game, and yet I don't see it. And that itself is a clue, I guess. That itself is a clue. Yeah, so these are like the ocean bottom and ocean top. And then this one, I'm gonna get rid of my tweaks there. And that's the LDR to HDR. So why is our console simply not drawing. We put a print here. I'm gonna do this. I'm going to do this. All right, let's just try running that again because we changed a couple things and let's minimize our uncertainty. Oh, look, it's open now. What did I do to fix that? That's exactly what we wanted to see. It opens very quickly. So it's just this begin and flush. Like, we're not... Something's happening. We're like switching to another shader later and not flushing, which is maybe an API problem here, but we'll deal with that. We'll deal with one topic at a time. Let's make dopendt like one. So now you can see it open. That's all we were going for. Yeah, it is very ugly. We will fix these colors, but before we fix them, let's bind the console to keys. So instead of having it open here, we're going to say back in player control, which is where all our input is handled. So if we press F1, I'll bind it to F1 for now. I don't remember how I know if shift is down. Let's, for interim thing, so I don't have to think about that yet, let's just do this. Okay, so F1, open small. Oh, it's not closing. F2, open big. Okay. F1, open small. Okay, but I want to toggle it. So why is toggle not working? Because I never set extent to the new thing. Wait, no, extent is this parameter. Wait, am I flaking? Like, how does the witness console work? I feel like I want it to toggle. I like the witness behavior and I want to duplicate the witness behavior. So let's see what that is again. Development mode takes a little longer to start than the release mode that everyone gets to play because release mode has all the assets bundled. Okay, so F1. Yeah, F1 toggles. So if you're open at all, so why does that happen? Well, it certainly doesn't happen here. Let's look at, I feel like it should happen there. Let's look at what the witness does. When does it call that? Oh God. Oh, it still works. Okay, so oh, that's a different time. So this just says, right, this is basically exactly what we want to do. Yeah, okay. We just look directly at the consoles. Yeah, you know what? Let's just do it exactly the same. So we... we actually put this out here and we say, let me comment this out for a second. I'll say target state is open small if if console open t target is greater than 0, target state is closed. Open or close console target state. Okay, so now we should have some toggling behavior, but only, yeah. And you know, if we start going in one direction, we reverse and stuff, so this is all good. Let's make that go faster. Let's put it at like 5. And now let's check if shift is being held. Wait. How did that witness one go again? Because this isn't going to be the behavior that I want. So we start at what did I do here? If you hit shift, you get big. Okay, this is some weird, I don't remember what my logic was behind this. It's actually totally different from what I just typed. So, yeah, all right. I'm going to trust past me that this is the behavior that I want. Closed. And then, so if something, I have to figure out how to check the shift flag because I haven't done this in a long time. Let's open big. Else, if console open t target is equal to 0, target sure. So now how do I check shift? I hope that I've done this functionality first of all. Let's see, we are going to modules inputs. Do I have key mod flags? I don't seem to have flags. We have a key code for shift. Wow, I might have to sidetrack while working on the console and go in and like add the... So here's the Windows version that does all the ugly dealing with Windows things. Yeah, well, let's add let's add something to our input event. Let's just make it a Boolean right now. Later, it can be flags of like, is shift pressed or is control pressed and all that. But for now, I'm just gonna say shift pressed is a bool. Well, is false, right? So we'll go into Windows input and we're gonna track the shift state, right? And then do Windows events already give us shift flags? That's the question. So here's our window proc, right? This is the horrible way that Windows passes you input events. And on a key down event, right, you get this W param and L param. I don't remember what information is in there. So let's take a look. Repeat count, the scan code, whether it's an extended key, context code, previous state, the transition state. So I don't feel like it tells us if shift is being held specifically. We have to watch for shift down and shift up. Let's do that. And this may not be the best way to do it, but we'll do it that. So VK shift. Okay. If W param is equal to VK shift, shift state equals true. This is really kind of the not fancy way to do it. And then when we have a different button event, we say event.shift, what did I call it? Pressed. Shift state. And then only set for who knows what's going to happen? Oh, I didn't then do this thing. So we say if event.shift pressed, do one thing, otherwise do the other thing. Who knows if that's going to work? So that's my non-shift pressed. That's my shift pressed. Hey, it works. So we've got little open, big open, and going back to zero. So that's pretty cool. That is, I call that a victory. Now, it is an ugly console. Although, you know, you can't quite tell how it looks until you're drawing text into it, because I don't want to pick some good console colors. And then in the absence of having text colors, so let's draw some text. And so like I said, we don't actually have text scrolling into the console yet. So let's make some. Let's say there's a variable called history that's an array of string, and that's just going to be all the strings that we print, one per line. And when we init console, we're going to add some things. I'm going to say add to history hello sailor. There are 69,105 leaves in the pile. And okay, so this history is probably something that we're going to append to as new stuff comes in the console, so we're going to want to draw it backwards. And we're just going to do that now. So we're going to say, after drawing the output rectangle, we're going to say, we want some padding on the left. So text x is x0 plus input font or report font character height, because this will give us some way of having the text padding being proportional to the size of the font, although not completely predictable, times report text left pad. Actually, yeah, let's call it left pad. And we're not even going to try to wrap the text yet. Like, if we go off the right, we just go off the right. And we'll fix that later. So text y is going to be Are we flipping these? Yeah, y0. So we're going to say, while true, we'll say while text y is greater than or equal to 0, because we're going to just keep drawing lines till we get to the top and then stop. I'll say index is history.count minus 1. If index is less than 0, break, because that's, we're done. At the end, we'll subtract 1 to go to the next line. And here we will say text is history sub index, effects is 0, and we'll draw some text. Let's go to some other place we draw text. Okay. So here's, I generally, when I have something with a lot of arguments, just paste text x, text y. Oh, the color, so I believe draw text. What is the color here? It's a vector 4. All right, so we want to use this report text color. And draw the text and the effect. So maybe that'll draw some things. Maybe I made a mistake. Oh, because, wait, what? I don't know what this is on about. There's some weird thing that happened in error messages lately where if we're threaded, they freak out, and I don't know why. Oh, that doesn't make any sense. You can't be a constant adjustable array of things. Okay, right. And then you want to add there. You want to take the pointer. Integer versus float. Because draw text takes integers. Okay. All right. Oh, I'm not going up a line. And that is a really ugly color. Okay, we're gonna adjust our text color to be much brighter. And we're gonna go up a line. I hope somebody caught that I didn't do that. All right. So, well, I'm not sure why the text is a little bit too low. Wait, is my coordinate system backwards? Oh, no, I'm saying minus, I should be saying plus. Sorry, I'm thinking in the wrong, yeah. So that's pretty good. I probably want some pad. Let's also put some pad before the bottom. So text y0 plus report text left pad, right? Okay, so that's, I didn't recompile, right? I don't think I did. Yeah, no, what? What? Why didn't that work? Let's make it a whole lot. Report text left pad. Oh, because I didn't multiply by repunt. Okay, let's just call this pad. We'll say pad is this and there. It's much more readable and understandable and less likely to make a mistake. So that's pretty cool. Now here's what we're going to do. Well, we're going to commit. So now I'm going to hope that I have a text input. I don't think that I do. I did not port text input, so that may be a fun thing to do next. That's again a situation, well, there's actually, okay. Let's fix the colors first because that's easy and I can't abide the ugliness, and then we'll start doing input. So, yeah, let's make it big. We'll print screen it, we'll go into Photoshop, and so slow. What? All right. What's going to look good here is a question. I don't even know what color space to be in. Let's sort of go, I don't know. Let's just see what we feel like. See, a good brown might not be bad. A good cyan kind of color might not be bad. Not that that's what this is, but I'm kind of feeling something in this range right now. What do you think about that? Oh, good point. I don't think I added this to source control, which means, all right. I usually remember that. Thank you for pointing that out. Okay, so we'll do that. And then the input region for now, let's see. Yeah, it's magic wand, the input region. No, that magic Photoshop won't do things for me. Let's make that, I don't know. Now the problem is, because this is alpha blended, we're not gonna get the exact colors because the alpha is not 1.0. We'll do this as a first approximation though, and the colors still won't be right. And then maybe we'll draw the console with alpha equals 1 later and get it right. Okay, so color dropper. Let's try that. And we'll brighten it up a little bit to make up for the blending. So this is 48, 98, 107. Background color, 48, 98, 107. And this one, actually, let's get this. It's a brighter, well, I don't know. This one, 49, 119, 117. So it's not going to be exactly what we picked, but it should be some approximation. Yeah, you know, okay. This is not eye-shatteringly ugly. It's also not great. But again, we can do some things. I want to leave a lot of that kind of stuff until we do like a juicy polish pass later on. But this is all right. We can work with this. Make it be an animated GIF tiled across the screen. Well, we could certainly do that, and we may do that later. Okay, but we gotta start doing text. Now, the first thing we have to do is ignore input when the console is open. So when the console is open, we have to shunt input over to somewhere else. Yeah. So let's go back to player control. So if console is open, console handle event. Return, right? Yeah. And then we'll say console handle event. Now this is not the way I do it in the witness in Braid, but we're just doing what we're doing right now. Okay, so now, there's no reason to make it a pointer. That pointer is just a C and C++ habit that is not necessary here. Okay, so we've got an event. Wait, we're still responding to it though. Why are we still? That's disturbing me. Why are all the events still happening? Why are all the events? Okay. This is really, I need to refactor this a little bit anyway. So Oh, duh. Yeah, I didn't look at the rest of this. Okay, here's the thing. There's a couple of things that we want to happen no matter what. So handle global events. We'll call them global events. Event, and if handle continue, right? So global events is going to be stuff like this F1 and F11, which we want to work regardless of if we're in game mode or editor mode or menu mode or whatever, right? So handle global event and then I guess I'm using that. Well, we'll just do that. So let's try that factorization. Expression is void because I didn't, right? Cool. Return false, we didn't handle it, or return true, we did handle it. We did handle it. Okay. So that's good. Now, if it was escape, well, that's sort of a game mode thing. I don't know. We'll think, because we might want escape to work in the editor too. I'm not sure. Okay. This whole console is open thing really needs to be out here regardless of what game mode we're in. So if the console is open, escape shouldn't do anything. Blah, blah, blah. Right? Okay. So I'm able to move. Console is open. I'm not able to move. Console is getting input. And then console is closing. I'm able to move. So you notice there's subtleties in here that you have to get right. You know, like I'm moving. Once I, that's a subtlety we didn't get right. So the problem is, this is sort of a global UI kind of problem. If we pressed a key and we opened the console before we released it, we're intercepting the release event. So that's a thing that we'll have to deal with later. Yeah. Okay, but for the most part, this is doing what we want. We're able to open and close, and it's all good. We're going in the menu, we're out of the menu. Console's open. If I hit escape, escape is going to the console and not to the menu. So, this might be a good time to ask for questions because the next thing that we're gonna do is start handling the input, and that's gonna take a little bit. So I may do a 5-minute break before we go on that, but before we do a 5-minute break, are there any questions? Yeah, I mean, opening the console probably should release all held keys. The thing is, I just don't store that information right now. So I'd have to add that layer to like the input library, which I should. But things like that are like a lower priority. My style of getting features done is I tend to do the baseline and like let some stuff be inconvenient until later. So we're getting the console done so you can type into it. And then later on, we will make some small things nice like that. How do I disambiguate my if statement syntax if condition a.c, b.c, that pointer equals 5 requires arbitrary look ahead to see that times is unary rather than binary? Well, so right now the if statement syntax doesn't really like that. In that kind of a case, like where there's an operator that could be unary or binary, I wouldn't say it's ambiguous, but what happens is the compiler resolves that in favor of the operator being binary, I believe. So, which is often not what you want. And so, but this is just sort of, it's one of those syntactical problems that language people have been aware of forever. It's why, for example, in C and C++, the parentheses are required on an if statement expression. In other languages, they don't do that, but then the curly braces are required on the then and else clause. For this language, my policy is I might have to fix that later, but I'm just not going to worry about it. Because I want to know, rather than believing the history of like why everybody thinks this is so important, I'm just going to chill and not worry about it for a while and know that we can fix it either way or in a totally different way later. And so that's fine. There is an optional then keyword that you can use after the if expression, but I'm intending not to use that as well. So it's just, you know, I'm just chilling and seeing what I think about it later, rather than a priori insisting that my grammar be, you know, completely, I don't want to say unambiguous, because there isn't really an ambiguity there. It's more like, is the parse what the programmer expects in all cases or not, right? Does every call to immediate begin require a call to immediate end or immediate flush? Not totally, because in theory, anytime you do something major to the graphics pipeline, it should call immediate flush. So if I switch the shader or switch the texture, in theory, it calls immediate flush. Now, that apparently doesn't happen all the time, because at first when the console didn't appear, I think it was due to something like that. But I don't want to debug that yet, because I don't want to get sidetracked from the subject of this stream, which is getting the console fully working. But I have taken note that there is potentially an issue with immediate flush, yes. Why not use the console to modify the value in the vars file instead of modifying the file manually? Well, you could do that. You could do both. You could have the console have the ability to save the file as well as editing it in your favorite editor. I don't think you want to force people to use the console to manipulate variables, because what if they want to use their text editor? Like, people type in their text editor all the time, which makes them very good at it, right? And they like the interface there, and they like whatever text editing facility. So you don't want to take that away from them. How are multiple inputs handled simultaneously, like two keyboards pressing the same or different key? Right now, we're just letting the operating system take care of that for us. So whatever the operating system does is what we're doing. Would it be bad to skip over subtitles like that in the interest of time? Subtitles like what? I don't understand that question. How do I decide what to do later? It's just my opinion, man, but the goal for this stream is to at least get to the point where I can type text into that input window of the console and it goes into the scroll back, right? Once we've got that, and then my stretch goal is to hook the variables up to the tweak file, which should be easy. Once we've got that, then that's a straightforward unit of functionality. And then the next unit is, okay, make a command system and let me type commands that do stuff. So, that's how I decide. I do whatever is necessary to get to that unit of functionality. Have I ever dabbled with forth-like math syntax? Yes. I used to program in languages that are forth-like and in fact did some implementation work on some, and I don't like it. Now that I am educated. Someone says, oh yeah, maybe backslash says ignore the following white space in the middle of an identifier until you get to the rest of the identifier. That could work. And then maybe, I guess, if you hit a new line first, that's an error. That could work. Yeah, I mean, I'll think about it. Someone's saying refactor the build file to take arguments from the command line to determine which backend you want to use, and then configure the key bindings in Commander accordingly. Yeah, I mean, I don't want to have a zillion key bindings to use different backends. I could. You already can do that. Like, I could have a different run command that says run some other backend, right? Or build could optionally take an argument for what backend to use, and if you don't specify it, it'll just use x64. I totally could do that, I just haven't bothered. Yeah. Will the console support expressions in this programming language? Probably not to start, because that is a relatively complex issue. It probably wants you to be able to link the compiler as a library, which I haven't done yet. That's non-trivial because you need to like decide what the interface is to applications and all that. So, subtleties, not subtitles. Nobody else on the team is programming games in this language yet. There's one person helping me implement the compiler so far. And, you know, later there'll be more people working on the game, I think. We'll see. It is time for me to take a 5-minute break. When we come back, we'll implement text input into the console. Am I going to use STB text edit? That's a good question. I'm not going to for this very beginning functionality. I'm just going to get it so I can type characters and delete characters. However, thank you for reminding me that STB text edit exists, because I forgot about that. And I would like to at least take a look at it. So maybe we'll stop this stream after we get the basics done, and then maybe we'll come back later and do a later stream with STB text editor or something. Good idea. Good idea. Okay. As soon as my tea is done steeping, we will start. I think I've got enough snacks. I kind of need to go to the store to get a wider variety of snacks. If the coding suffers in this next segment, it's because there aren't enough different snacks. Okay. The snacks make me more productive is based on how I feel when I'm eating snacks. Okay. I'll take one or two questions if anybody has them now before we go on and do the text input. I don't see any questions. All right. So I'm just looking at right now the text input that we use in the witness, which again, you know, when I originally wrote it, it was something very simple. And then we added a bunch of functionality. Actually, let me get my to-do list. I need to get a new piece of paper. Because my old to-do list was spilled upon. Okay, so you know, I feel like we're just going to do our own text input and not use STV text, because this is probably what it does, and I'd probably rather all have this native in our own programming language. Anyway, so what we're going to do is just do the very most basic part of the text input, which is appending characters and drawing it, which really should be very little code. And then maybe in a further stream, we'll do all the clipboard stuff, like copying and pasting or navigating by word or whatever that people do. Okay. And then actually, And also, similarly, there was some console functionality. That comes later. So for now, we're just going for the basic stuff. Basic stuff. And, you know, I'm not really gonna look at any of this. Because it's probably all for this other stuff. Most of it. You know, as we've just seen, actually drawing the text is pretty simple. But I am going to make a new file for text input because it's something that we'll use in the editor and all that. And I am going to make a struct for it because you may want to instantiate it. It's likely that you'll want to instantiate it multiple times. Someone's asking, will there be a way to disable the console for game developers, or is it a permanent feature? In the witness, we turn it on or off depending on whether you are in release mode or not. And you usually do that with some kind of, you know, in C++ you would do that with a preprocessor directive. And here we would probably do that with a static if. Actually, let me put that down. Console static if. That's a small enough thing that we would just do that as an extra thing on any particular stream. It's like not a whole stream subject. I was gonna, before this stream is over, let me make a mark. We were gonna add console variables to the tweak file. Okay. Is the in-game console something you think would make a good STB style library? I don't know, because anytime that you're really interacting with rendering a lot, I don't know. The basic kind of console like we're gonna do, probably. But as you get fancier, it becomes unclear. But I don't, you know, doing STB style libraries is not my wheelhouse. I've actually never done it. So Sean's probably much better at thinking about how to make things reusable than I am. So there is that. Okay, let's go back to main. Actually, let me go to, I don't know what edits I did to draw, but we don't want them. So let's kill that. We'll go to main. We will add next to console, text input. And let's go make the file. Text input is a struct, and we'll leave it at that for now. We'll add this to source control so that we don't forget. For some reason, my console didn't complete that. That was weird. Redeclaration. I have a text input struct in editor already. Oh, but it might be empty. Let's go see. Well, yeah, it's basically nobody's using it. So we'll start with these things. Okay. And we still run. Okay, that's great. Still got a console. Can't type into it. Well, we can type, but nothing good happens. All right, so let's make a handle event for text input. Let's call it this. Why not? Okay, so when we get an event, for now, we're just gonna say if event.type event.type is not equal to keyboard return print text input got a keyboard event. or no, we don't want keyboard. We want text input is a separate type, right? So in Windows especially, but I think all operating systems do it this now. Like when you press the A key, for example, you get two events. You get that the button A went down, but then you also get a text input event that like translates the A key to some number of characters, you know, based on locale and region mappings and stuff. And for text input, you want to listen to what the operating system has to say about all that stuff. So text input, it's got to be an event type text input, right? And for now, we're only taking the first character or whatever. Got a keyboard event for UTF-32 code there key. Okay, so now when the console goes, it's going to have its own text input. And when it handles an event, it's just going to say handle event. Input should handle that event. Whoops. We've of course got to pass the event that we want to handle, or we will not have much to do. Okay, so now, whoops, this is game, right? And then I open the console, and right, so see we're getting keyboard events and we're ignoring those, but the text input, we're printing that the text input struct got that event. Okay, so this is all working just fine. Now we won't be able to delete yet because delete is a, well, actually let's do this. Because we're gonna wanna handle other things. Okay, so I'm gonna put a buffer and I'm just gonna have a max buffer size because why not? Max buffer size is, I don't know, 1024. That's as long as a thing. No, 81920, okay, fine. No, that's too much. 8,000, it's not over 9,000. Okay, so then I'm gonna say input buffer is max buffer size of U8. So we're gonna be dropping characters in and out of this. And init actually, let's call it input and not this. All right, so in init, we're gonna actually, no, what are we gonna do? Yeah, so this string here is for exporting our information about what our buffer is to the rest of the world. So we're gonna say, we're gonna call this text. I hope that doesn't break someone. Now we'll call it, yeah, text dot data is input buffer dot data and text dot count is zero because we have no text. It already was zero, but whatever. So emitted equals true, and then we init. Wait, didn't I change it from this to what? Okay. Now, I might have broken something in my old editor code. Right. But that's something we want to pull over here anyway. Oh, look, these are all methods on text input that I just put into the program to make the editor compile, because the editor is ported in an incomplete way, and I needed stubs for all this. So now we have stubs for all this. Wait, that's a panel. We don't want that. But we want all this text input stuff. So these are going to just be we don't need these for the console, because if the console's open, our text input is always active. But these you might use to, like, say, go into a mode where we're brighter or we're not so bright, so that, you know, we look like we're being typed into or not. Ugh, this tea is weird. This is the first time I've had this particular tea. Can't say I like it very much. Okay. Is active. We'll just make an active. Why not? Return input dot active handle events. Well, editor is doing this a different way than we do now. Refactor this to work with the new system. Get results. Well, we don't really need that, but we'll say return text. Reset. We'll just call init on input again. Activate, entered, and escaped. Okay. So. Oh, we've got this add text. We're not going to bother making that happen yet because we don't care. And then draw. We do care. This is a three ginger tea by some company that I've. I wanted something without caffeine because I've been drinking caffeinated tea all morning. All right, so let's see if this compiles. Right, we haven't added this variable. Okay, so let's be a little fancy here. Since we've got this activate, we will say. If let's just say let's make a shorter name. Target is console open to target. We gave that a long name to export it to the rest of the program. So we'll say if target is equal to zero, deactivate. Text input, else, activate text input. So that later, if that does anything fancy, is it called text input? It's called input. So later, if we do anything fancy there, the fanciness will happen. And, oh, when we draw the console, let's call draw on the text input. Oh, we were calling activate every frame here. That's funny. So we're going to draw input with font and oh, right. So this was a padding thing. We're going to have to pad this later, but we won't pad it yet. And let's make this take a vector 4. No, that'll break the editor. Let's just break the editor. Why not? We'll break the editor and we'll fix it because I kind of want to. Yeah. And then this is width, not width. Okay. I don't know. Right, so we broke the editor in at least one place. Yeah, I mean, all this has to go. One point seven. I don't know. None of these colors have been thought very carefully about. So, integer text alpha. Float text alpha. This is just like when panels in the editor are taking input or not, we draw them more or less transparently. Oh yeah, this is returns float. And okay, so we're back here. We want to return. We're not using this. That's the problem. Okay. So we're still not drawing anything because our text input has no text, but we're entering the draw procedure. Right. And you know what? To save CPU time or whatever, or just to perturb our system minimally, we're only going to draw if the draw the text input. Actually, we're only going to draw anything if we're not completely closed. Okay, so we're closed. Now we open it, and now we're getting this text input draw print down on the bottom here. Okay, does this make sense? Does everybody get what we're doing? Everybody get what we're doing. Let's fix the drawing first. Let's pretend. Let's pretend that there's a string already in the text input, and we'll draw it, and then we'll put the editing in. So we'll say S is, unfortunately, there's a radio connected to my game, right? So that's going to be what the text input believes is its current state. And now we're just going to draw some stuff. So we're going to say effect is zero for now. And we're going to draw text in the font at text X, text Y, text color. S effect, right? Again, we have integer versus float. We gave a float and it wants S64, so screw it. Okay. All right. So that's not too bad. Here's the thing. I'm gonna emphasize this text using the technique that I like to do. Offset font, let's just call it B, something really small. Font dot character height times O dot O 5. If B is less than 2, B equals 2. And we're going to go plus B minus B background color. And BG color is make vector 4, 0, 0, 0, O dot 9. Let's make it not a complete black. So K is O dot 1. K, 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 O dot O 5. All right. Oh. So I think I need to lower the precedence of this autocast operator because it always annoys me to have to do this. Maybe casting in general gets a different precedence. Okay, check that out. Now I know what I'm typing there. Okay, so we're gonna wanna pad this because it's kinda coming out of the console a little bit. Yeah, you can't have a variable called XX right now. It's a keyword. What do you want? There is some implicit casting, but not very much. There's less than C++, but more than Go, for example. Okay. Questions? Everyone following along? Is everyone following along? Okay, let's pad this a little bit. So we're gonna, we have this pad variable that we used. Well, let's do the same thing for input font. It'll have a different pad. Let's open a scope for drawing the text. Okay, so drawing background and drawing input text. Okay, so we draw that. Now, the what we're not doing yet is drawing a cursor. Oh, but let's finish doing the padding first, right? So here's our X pad. Now, the thing is, we're going to want a little bit of Y padding on the input, and we're going to want to build that into the into the height of the input section. So what we do is we say input Y0 is the very bottom of the console, and then we add the character height. We're going to want to add a little bit more. And then, I mean, this is not going to be quite right because there's going to be a little too much extra height at the top because that seems to be the way a lot of fonts are, but we can tweak that later with maybe a variable tweak or something. Whoops, I went too far. So here, then we'll add an input pad here. Input text left pad. What? That must be a thing I pasted from the other pad. Report text left pad. Okay. Right. Let's make a variable. We'll just leave it at 0.5 right now. All right. Okay. Like I said, there's too much space on top. Input text. Top pad ratio is 0.5 plus 1 plus input text top pad ratio. Okay, that's pretty good. That top ratio should be a little less. And again, we'll put all these in the tweak file later. Okay, so that's all right. Now we're going to draw a cursor. And what we're going to do for the cursor is we're going to have it flash between colors right where we're going to type. You know, right here at the end of the text. And it's going to be a lot like what we did in the menu yesterday. See, remember this? How we have the text color glowing? And, you know, when we confirm things, it glows to a different color for a second. So I don't think we're going to do the two color thing yet, although for juiciness, let me write that down. Like maybe it's cool if the cursor is hot if you've been typing fast and then cools down. We're going to have a cool console. But first, we have to have a console. So we're going to do something like this, where we're just animating the color of the cursor, right? So let's go to menu, where we did that. When the input text is bigger than the screen, are you going to push the text left and handle it when text is deleted? We're certainly going to handle when text is deleted today. When it gets pushed to the left of the screen, we might save that for like the juiciness or whatever, because I don't know. We'll figure it out. Anyway, and display the words per minute and make the console start on fire if you type too fast. Yeah, we'll do a particle system on the console. Okay, now, so I'm looking for this text color. Yeah, so remember we did this stuff. So I'm going to go into text input, and I'm going to say cursor color is get cursor color and escape file. We're going to just make a procedure called get cursor color. And you know what? For now, we're just going to return, after all that I said, we're just going to return white, because all we're going to do to begin with, actually, you know what? Let's copy some of this, because we're going to want this. Wait, we're not going to want that. We just want the now, and then the, where's our cosine? Yeah. Oh yeah, we can have the cursor flash or reset every time you press a key. That'll feel active, right? Let's not do that yet. But we'll copy all this. We're going to copy all that, but we're not going to do it yet. We're just going to return white. Let's make sure that compiles. It does. So see why it's so nice to have your program compile quickly? We're up to 36,000 lines, going on 37, and it still compiles fast. OK, so we get the cursor color, and we want width is, right. So we're getting the width in pixels of the font and the string and the effect. See, this is a little bit of redundancy. Like we could, sometime in the future, we could supply a way to get the width back when you draw, because this is doing redundant whatever, but it's fine. So we get the width and we'll say cursor x is, text x plus width, and cursor width, let's call these cw and ch, because we're going to want that, and I don't know, let's just make it a square cursor right now. We just want something on the screen. And oh no, you know what? Well, there's something fancy you can do where you like get the dimensions of a capital letter that's wide, like the letter X or something, and then you use those. But okay, we init the cursor dimensions later. For now, we just say it's a square. And let's go back to console quad and do the same thing. The cursor. So this is cursor color. X0 is, what did we call it? Cursor, let's just put it here. Text X plus width. Y0 is text Y. x1 is text x plus cw, y. This is a little redundant. But these are probably going to be separate variables, so it's fine. Okay. Procedure call did not match any of the possible overloads. Why not? Because it wants ARGB color. I really have to get consistent about that. Okay. Ooh, that's not right. We've got a little, oh, because we have to change our shader and stuff. We're on shader text, first of all. But that also looked like we were drawing a bunch of crap along the bottom, which is no good. But first, let's... So we want to set this shader, set it down here. Yeah, we're drawing a very wide rectangle. I do not know why we are doing that. Why are we drawing a wide? Oh, because you know what? We're in the wrong coordinates right now. Right now we're in unit scale coordinates for the screen. This is another thing that I should get more consistent about. So here's the thing. Often when you're doing 2D rendering, it's convenient to think about, let me write this down. Often when you're doing 2D rendering, it's convenient to think about the screen as going like from 0 to 1, because then you don't care about the resolution. But actually, that's not very good, because if you care about getting things pixel perfect, you need to set up a transform where you know where the individual pixels are, right? And so a long time ago, when I did the font rendering system, I made it work with a 0 to 1 by default. And the problem is now, on a 0 to 1 scale, well, now if that's what's happening, then I don't understand why we're not just drawing a giant, giant rectangle. Set, what is it called? Rendering 2D. So I have a 2D right-handed for, and a 2D right-handed unit scale. I think when I draw text, it resets the transform, and I need to clean that up. So I've made a note there to clean it up. We're going to call our rendering 2D right-handed normally here. See what happens. Still too big, which I guess kind of makes sense. What is happening? X0, Y0. X1, Y0. X1, Y1. I don't know why this rectangle is so darn wide. Does anyone have any idea? Like, it's almost as wide as the text, but not quite, which is weird. Like what even would do that? This is a really, X1 should be X0 plus something. Oh, that's a good point. Oh, duh, right, okay. Yeah, thank you. I don't know what I was thinking. So we were kind of drawing it backwards. Yeah, duh, okay. So now let's do the thing where we init. We're going to want to do two things. We're going to want to compensate for this baseline. Let's do that first, because we don't want to start. Basically, text y, whenever you draw text, is at the baseline, and you have descenders, which go below the baseline, and you have ascenders, which go above the baseline, right? So we actually probably want the cursor to go below the baseline somewhat, because otherwise it's a little funky. So I don't remember if I store that information. I hope I do. Is that in modules now? Let's see what our dynamic font has. It's got all sorts of stuff for, I guess I do use FreeType. I don't use STB right now. I keep forgetting. I don't have a baseline metric. So I'm gonna put that on the list for later. I already feel like we're not gonna get to that stuff before I feel like I need to eat today. I don't see a baseline kind of thing. So let's just for now make this the geometry of like a capital M, which is a typical thing. So when the text input inits, I'm gonna say M width and M height. No, let's make this local when we draw, because we might call draw with different fonts all the time. So I'm going to say with M height. So we say S is just a string with M. This is really dumb. Get string width in pixels. Do I have a... There's, okay, so I'm gonna cheat. I'm gonna get the M width, but the height, yeah. I'm also gonna make a note to get a better M height later. We're just gonna use this character height field for the height. So we're just gonna use the width, right? So M width is this width, and M height equals font.characterHeight. Incomplete can do better than this. Why not just make the cursor a line? We probably should. I don't know, I'm used to seeing a square cursor from Emacs, that's all. But actually, if you're gonna go insert in the middle of the text, you actually want the cursor to be a line. But you know what? Because I'm most of the way through doing this, we're gonna make the cursor be a box, and we'll make it be a line later. Because that's just the way I am. It's a good point. The cursor should be a line, probably. Maybe it expands to a box if it's at the end and then contracts to a line. That could be juicy. Box versus line cursor. Okay. M width, M height. Whoops. Okay, effect used before declared. Oh yeah. Okay. So that's a reasonable width, and we'll just cheat it down a little bit. People are asking for features that's way ahead of where we're at right now. I tell you, I'm just going to get this to the point where we can type text, and then I'm going to lunch because I'm going to be hungry. All right, let's make the cursor glowy, and let's offset it a little bit. Let's just make a text input cursor height tweak. Cursor Y tweak is O.3, I don't know. So, we're just going to say sign. I thought I put a negative, but I didn't. Oh, that's too much. All right, that's all right. That'll do us for now. So let's play with the color. The color is going to be, let's just say for now, last key press time is 0. We'll come back and fill that in a second, and we return a color. Okay. The thing is, I think we want to use the text color maybe, so let's try that. Okay. That's pretty cool. That's good enough for now for that. So I think, oh yeah, well wait, let's do, we can actually now set this, instead of just printing when we got a keyboard event, let's set last key press time. Using input text input. All right. So now it's just flashing, but as I press keys, it's white. See, it snaps every time. See? That's production value, man. That makes you feel good about typing. Would the text input event be used for in-game text input like naming a character? Probably, yes. Okay, now all we have to do is put text into the buffer and use the buffer. So here for now, I'm going to do temporary, not yet UTF-8 clean, just to be lazy and not have to think about it, and so I can go to lunch. We're going to assert that key is less than 128. We're going to assert that it's ASCII, right? If you start getting European characters and stuff, we're not going to display that correctly yet. Let's just put this up there. And we will say if text.count is less than max buffer size, input buffer sub text.count equals key text.count plus equals 1. I think that's it. Instead of writing unfortunately, we're going to say S is text. Right, it wants a U8, right? in line 36. Oh, we're resetting to nothing all the time, though. Why is that happening? We must be calling init. And who's printing? Is the console still printing the events? Yeah, we don't want the console to print the events like that. So, oh, handle event is calling init input. We want to say if not initted. So if we draw or take input, we only init if we're not initted. Hey! Okay, so we want to handle the delete key. I don't know why the delete key is giving me a G event. That's weird. That must be a problem in our input system. So we're going to have to debug that before I go to lunch. All right, so for now, well, let's handle enter first. So when we get an event, it could be a text input, right? Or it could be keyboard. Right, and again, we can go back and look at some of our other code. If pressed, do I have an enter in here? No. If key is equal to key code dot enter, right? Else if key is equal to, let me see what these are called. Whoops. What in Emacs kills me sometimes. I guess it wanted me to capitalize the I. So we have enter. We have escape. I don't know what escape should do in this case. Let's just do enter or where's delete? We don't have delete. Okay, we're gonna have to do delete. And backspace. Our input system doesn't even have the concept of these things. Key code dot backspace. Right? Okay. So if it's enter, what we're going to do, this is an immediate mode data structure thingy. So we're just going to say entered equals true, and whoever calls us is going to check for entered and do something with it. So the console, escape to close the console? No, because, well, it's maybe escape closes the console. I don't know. Anyway, so we handle the event, and then we say if input.entered, then if input.entered, we do something with the text. Text is get result input, and then we reset the input. And with that text, I'm gonna add output, right? And this is just gonna say, copy is copy string of to add, because this is going, we're taking memory responsibility for this because, we're taking memory responsibility for this because now it's becoming ours, and I'm going to say, Wait, no. What am I doing? This is the console has the output, not the right. So we're gonna say copy is copy string of text. The console is taking responsibility over this, and it's gonna add it to this history, right? And we're not gonna limit the length of history right now. It's just gonna grow indefinitely. We might later put a limit on that. All right, so we open the console and we type, and it goes there, and for some reason, so we're getting text events for extra characters. Like enter is giving me a J because J is, key code 10, and like G is, I don't know. I have to figure out why that's happening, but other than that, we're mostly mission accomplished at this point, right? We're not interpreting what I type yet, and we'll do that later, but this is pretty good. Look how hot the cursor gets when I type, man. So I have to fix this character J thing, because if I don't, then delete won't work either. Like delete will like insert a J or a G and then delete it again, and you won't really be able to delete anything. So let's do that. Let's so why is this happening? Why is this happening? We go all the way back to Windows input here. So theoretically, right, I want to check this code here. So text, it really does need to be a text input event, right? That's the only time in which we put stuff into the input buffer. If it's a keyboard event, we do not. So we are generating a text input event. Right, because we're so we're getting a WM care event. So I'm actually wondering, what do we do in Windows to filter this out? If key code is equal to 10, let me just verify that that's what is happening, right? So no. Oh, now it's giving me a capital M. So it's more like uninitialized. Like what? What? Let me just print out. So when that happens, wait, I'm not printing text input at all. Okay, what the hell is going on there? That's only if key code is equal to 10. Sorry, duh. I wanted to just see what is happening. So I hit enter, it gives me a 13 for text input. Why would that give me a J? I might be getting a glyph not found. This could be like a rendering weirdness where like if I get a glyph not found, it gives me a random glyph that I've drawn before. I'm going to put on the list, we're getting lots of small things to do here. Glyph not found. Should log or something, which it probably doesn't right now. Right, because I believe we're getting a text input. Oh, since we are getting text input for those things, right, I remember now. So here's the thing is, yeah, it's confusing. Thinking about events is confusing, text events. We're just gonna handle it here. So if key is equal to key code.enter, this may not be the best way to handle it as a system, so kind of what I want to do here is evaluate this and, you know, see if I want to structure this in a different way. Because so part of what is the job of all this stuff here is to translate from Windows's pretty crazy event system to one that we actually want to use, potentially for everybody, or one option that everybody will have about, you know, what their event library API could be. And so I'm kind of just working through that, and I don't really remember the decisions I made early on, and I honestly wasn't trying that hard when I did all this initially, as you could tell, because like delete wasn't even there. Else if key is equal to key code dot backspace, otherwise we insert things. So this is going to be weird, because if we hit other unhandled keys, we'll get garbage for now, but we'll have to come up with a consistent way to know whether a key is like a visual key or not, a visual text key. And I believe Windows, has this official way to do that. Yeah, we could like filter for characters greater than 31 or whatever. In fact, let's do that for now. But incomplete, this should be handled by the lower level API. Like Windows is telling us in some way that we're ignoring currently, oh, this is a visual character, or oh, this is like a non-visual thing. And we just have to hook that up. But for now, in the spirit of getting things working, we're just gonna do this. Left type is U32. Yeah. So we'll cast these for now. Because we're abusing this a little bit, we're abusing, like, key codes is an enum that's supposed to be different from UTF-32s, and it's, like, not totally, which is another thing that we need to clean up. Okay, so we set entered to true, I thought. You know what? I bet enter is 10. Yeah, this is ugly. There we go. So the problem is enter is 10. Text input for enter on Windows is 13. Ugh. So really, we really would rather be handling this with the button press. Handle non-visual key presses with the button press API, or with as button presses not as text input, look up how to hook this up in Windows. Because otherwise we have to deal with weird stuff like this, right? Okay, that is, though, everything that I wanted to do today, or in this stream. I feel like I'm going to do another stream tonight where we take this further, but... and I probably won't do this kind of cleanup next. In the next stream, probably what I'm going to do is hook up the commands to actually do things, and then we'll do a cleanup stream later on, right? So, oh, you know what? Let's check this in and let's do my stretch goal, because I kind of want to go to lunch, but this won't take long. Okay, stretch goal is putting these kind of tweaks into into the tweak file. Now, one thing is, our tweak file doesn't understand vectors like vector4 yet, so we can't put these in there. So we won't yet, but we'll make a note, make the dot variables file understand vectors, so we can put these in there. Otherwise, I'm going to say, I'm not going to do the fonts yet. We'll do this in a second step. All right, so we're going to say, console visuals is a struct, and it's got all this stuff in it, right? And then we're going to using console visuals. So hopefully that works. Why does that? Oh. Does using it the global namespace not work? Ay, ay, ay. Okay. This is annoying. Yeah. So this is going to, be a small compiler thing to fix. Basically, the parser just doesn't do the right thing when you say using it top level. It has in the past. Oh no, wait. No, duh, it's just saying there's no storage. This is what happens when I don't eat lunch. No, it's fine. Scribbling that off my to-do list. Okay, so this still runs. This is good. Okay, so now I'm gonna go back to main. I'm going to say register. How does it? What's it called? Add value folder. So we're going to add value folder console visuals, right? So now that, is that not what I call, oh. Let's put it at public. Okay. So now, in theory, this is where you sort of, this is the test of the system that you have built. Let's go to all.variables. We'll make a thing called console visuals. And let's go I'm just going to copy these names out. I need an Emacs mode that does this. Okay, I'll tidy this up more later, but the point being, okay, so let's pop open the console. We can't change the colors yet, but let's change X0. Hey, look. I don't know why. Oh, because OpenT, we don't want to set OpenT in here. If I change OpenT, it'll like tweak it. There we go. Let's say dopendt is 5,000, so it'll be really snappy when I open and close it, right? Or 0.1. Oh, that's so slow. Oh, God. 1. Speed up. 5. Let's go. You know, I don't know. I kind of like the idea of it not going to the edges of the screen. Let's just try that for now, so it doesn't go totally to the edges of the screen. Turn off the music. We can edit the pads, so input text left pad, all that stuff. So that's 3, 5. This, I don't, yeah, that's a weird variable that I'm gonna have to think about the necessity of. But there, so those tweaks work. Now, so I could enable console font tweaking now, like you could change the font names. But the thing is, let's put the font names there, first of all. The thing is, we might have to have a special hook about the font names. Like, because we look up the fonts once at init time and et cetera. Anyway, input font name and report font name. Oh, do backspace. I never did backspace. Good point. Oh, I thought I was done. I'm not done. Input font name and report font name is that. So okay. Let's at least first make sure that this works. So let's change, well, let's make sure it still compiles. Okay, good. Let's just do the full down. Let's just do it the full way. So in init, we're also going to say init console fonts, right? And init console fonts is going to do this. And the hot loader when we reload variables will say we may have changed console fonts, so let's re-init them. This is really just to be showy. Probably few people will do this. All right. So our console is open. I don't have backspace yet. It's true. Okay, so what fonts do I have at my disposal? Right now I could only use fonts that we're distributing with the game that are in the game's font folder. We don't look at system fonts because then you're using stuff you might not ship, and that's a mistake. So let's say input font name is carminabold.otf. Hey, look, it changed. And let's say report font name is Anonymous Pro. Is that a TTF or an OTF? TTF. Hey, isn't that cool? So, you know, we have, I just think this is some pretty cool functionality that we have here, is all I'm saying. Let's leave this as inConsolata for now. And just to be fancy, I'm gonna keep Carmina as this font, even though everyone else on the team is sick of Carmina at this point. Okay, so let me check that in. Console tweaks are hot loadable. That is pretty sweet if I say that myself. Okay, we need backspace to work. So you don't have a console if you can't delete your frickin' work. So let's go to Windows input, vk delete. Is vk back backspace? I'm going to assume vk back is backspace. So vk enter. So I've just got this giant, this should probably be a lookup table later or whatever, but right now it's this giant sty of if statements. So we're just going to say, if it's back, return backspace. If it's delete, we return delete. Right. And, oh, I can't delete backspace. Why not? Either I'm not handling it correctly or I'm not getting it. Because I'm not doing anything. Let's make sure we actually are getting it. We are not getting it. Okay, so Windows backspace VK is what? It is VK back. Okay. Maybe we don't get that as a text input. I would believe that. This is something we'll have to clean out and okay, we're getting it. So we don't get that as a text input, and we'll have to formalize later what comes in as text input and what doesn't, because this is our API now, right? This is not Windows. I believe text input is checked in. Yeah, we just didn't change it that time. Okay, so now we will just say, again, this is also gonna count as a key press that whites up our cursor. And so if it's a backspace, we say, if text.count is greater than 1, text.count minus equals 1. Kabam! Oh, we're ignoring repeats right now. We're going to want to handle repeats. Did I say greater than 1? It's greater than 0. Duh. You gotta be able to delete the first character. Okay. So key repeat is gonna need to happen. I insist on that. I don't know why we're not. Yeah. Key repeat for backspace. But basically, this is what I wanted to get done in this stream. So I feel good. And next stream, we will make the commands go somewhere. Backspace should be 8 in WMCare or whatever you use for text input. Right, so WMCare. Yeah, I'm just not intercepting that. So and the key repeats probably happen in WMCare, right? Let's try that. I'm still not exactly comfortable with this because this particular mapping of stuff to text is a very it's a very Windows-specific thing, and I'm not sure how much of it I want to carry over into a higher-level API kind of thing. I'm not getting repeats. Maybe, let me close this. Maybe I'm filtering out repeats somewhere else. Maybe I just don't get them. It is true that using without storage should give you a better error message. That is true. That is true. Okay. Anyway, this is good enough that I'm happy going to lunch on this. And maybe I'll do a stream this afternoon. It depends on how much other work on other things that I have to do today. Am I getting repeats when typing? Yes. So if I press A and hold it down. So something is happening where I'm not getting repeats. Oh, wait, I am now. Maybe I just didn't recompile correctly. Hey, I'm happy. Sort of. I mean, the question of how much of Windows' idiosyncrasies do I... Oh, there's a crash. Probably when there's too many lines or something. Let's see. I thought I was done, but I wasn't. Basically, to cause that crash, I had just hit enter and held it down. So let's see. Now we're not crashing. Oh, and then we did. And then frickin' Visual Studio took my enter key press. Wait. What is even happening? Oh, I'm not using LLVM, first of all. So let's do that. Let's use LLVM's debug info. Otherwise, we won't be able to see a damn thing. Okay, so. We're asserting, okay. We are asserting that the glyph index exists. So that other thing wasn't a missing glyph problem. Okay, so instead of asserting, we're going to log. So we're going to log because a missing glyph is something that should not really be a fatal error. Where was I logging recently? Bars. I just like to go copy things. Okay, so font. So what are our asserts? I'm gonna leave some of them for now. I'll go through and clean all this up at some point. If we continue to use free type as standard, I mean, I guess even if we switch to STB true type, we would log print font unable to find a glyph for oh. Yeah, unable to find a glyph for UTF-32 character percent. And we probably should say in what font it is. Find a glyph in font whatever, font.name. Okay, so we'll log unknown glyphs. And maybe we should change the return value as well, I don't know. Now, why we're getting an unknown glyph, I also don't know. Huh. Is there, I guess it's crashing then. What are we doing here? Uh-oh. We should just return null, I guess. And then, anytime, we're gonna let finder create glyph fail. This is a whole question of like, oh, maybe you should return a sentinel glyph. So, okay, and that expects it to fail. Whoops. Oh, wait, this is fine. So here we just say if glyph. Yeah, so some people were fine with it failing and other people are not. Okay. So I probably pasted wrong variable. No? Okay. Let's see. This is very weird. Now it's infinite looping. So, I may just have to assert there again and then set a breakpoint to see why it's infinite looping. This is bad though. I mean, why are we asking it about UTF-32 character zero in the first place? There's two problems. So Wait, no. If we only want to say this, this used to be an assert glyph index. So that's, I put the wrong thing there. That's my bad. This is always going to be UTF-32-0. So, okay, I this is one of those things where I'm a little hungry and I forgot things. So here's what's actually going on. I was totally doing the wrong thing. Finder create glyph has two modes. Either you're finding the glyph for a UTF-32 character, in which case glyph index is 0, or you're finding a glyph index that you know in the font and UTF-32 is 0. So this if actually is about, are we in Unicode mode or are we in glyph index mode? And I don't really even think it's correct to say glyph index can't be 0, right? Because a glyph, the 0th glyph in the thing is fine. Okay, so we still have a crash though. Let's find out where that is. Like, I don't even know what's causing this at a high level. It's very curious. Okay, so we're asking, we're passing an invalid pointer to convert UTF-8 to UTF-32. That's fine. Well, it's not fine, but we know what it is. We're converting to temporary glyphs. That's a well-known thing. We're prepping text. Okay, so this is the first step in drawing text. We have a totally whacked out text pointer. Why? Why do we have a totally whacked out text pointer? That is what I want to know. Like, unless we're freeing stuff somehow, which we should not be, it's like the, as soon as things go off the screen, like, let's watch this again. It's so weird. So let's go to the big screen and see if it 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. No. Now, well, it went a while. So like it's getting stomped. Text. Okay. Let's go to the right file. This is curious. So we're just subscripting history. I'm not sure if we have array bounds checked. Let's assert index is greater than or equal to 0. I'm not sure in which backends array bounds checks are actually enabled right now. I know they're not in x64. I'm not sure about LLVM. I think they work in LLVM. They work in C. Index is less than history.count. If that goes off, that'll tell us something. Okay, that didn't go off. So weird. Are we like somehow accidentally freeing the text in some goofy way? That would be crazy. For text print. Percent, comma, index text. I'm just going to print it every time, or for history. We're going to print the entire history to see if it gets mangled, right? So, whoa. Okay, you know what this is? This is another empty string problem. Remember yesterday, we had a weird thing with the way the compiler was handling empty strings. We have that again. So, but it's a slightly different case that I'm not sure I totally understand. Anyway, when we hit enter, let's go to the text input. Okay, wait. Yeah. So when we reset the text input, we call init, which you'll recall. Oh. Okay. Yeah, this is a weird thing. I need to think about this. Yesterday when we were having that other empty string problem, I was saying, an empty string that comes as a literal should have its data pointer always be null. That's true. However, like random system things are gonna give you non-null data pointers, like here. And so what I actually think is, you can, in an if statement, say something like if s whatever, and this is supposed to be testing this for empty. It may be testing the data pointer and not the count, right? So I think what's actually happening is we're doing something like this, and and we're testing the data pointer, so the string's probably evaluating as true. Because that's a sidetrack from what I want to do, I've put it on the list of like compiler bugs to look into. It's probably related to yesterday's thing. And in the meantime, I'm going to put a workaround. In the get result. So result is text if result.count is zero, result.data is null, cleanup workaround for compiler bug involving empty strings. Return result. I bet that fixes it. I bet. So yeah, as long as I'm not empty, I'm fine. And then empties, so many empties. I keep doing empties. Yeah, that was it. So it was just that, somewhere someone's testing a string for false and it was evaluating as true because we're checking the data pointer instead of the count. And that is a compiler level bug and it shall be fixed in an upcoming stream. I'll probably do a stream sometime this week where we go for smaller compiler things. In the meantime, let's stop printing the entire history. All right, so that's what I wanted to do today. Thank you everybody for coming along. I'm gonna get lunch and do other work and maybe do a stream tonight, I don't know. We'll see, but thanks for coming by. And if you missed part of this, it'll be available on YouTube later on. It was pretty cool. We've done the whole graphical basics of a command console today, including a little bit of polish, like it popping in and out smoothly and having different levels of opening. And we have a flashy cursor, and we could change the fonts and all the various visual tweak values with our hot-loaded variable system that we demonstrated in previous streams. So all that is good, and we will continue building on that later on in the next stream by making that console actually, the things that you type actually do things. So thanks everybody, and see you later.